Hi, my name's Steve Kinney, and this is a course on using React with TypeScript. TypeScript not only adds critical safety features, but also adds powerful developer experience features that make your application easier to reason about and work with. In this course, we'll see how TypeScript syntax can mostly disappear while still providing all the necessary safety features to support you. We'll see how a few simple tweaks can provide powerful hints that make your components easier to understand. We'll explore runtime type safety with Zod and add robust schema validation for data sources we don't control. Finally, we'll look at best practices for using TypeScript with your design system or component library. Build rock-solid applications that you and your team feel confident building on for years to come.
The core point is if TypeScript cannot, through any way, shape, or form, figure out what something should be by looking and analyzing your code, it will then decide it as any. And any could be anything. Shocker, right? And arguably, that gets you no different than you were in JavaScript, right? And so, like, even if this was a JavaScript component, you were migrating a legacy code base, one could flip the, you know, turn strict mode off for a hot minute, flip the J to a T, and still be in business, right? But what I want to show you is, for starters, the fact that we can get all those red squiggly lines to go away without writing a single line of JavaScript or TypeScript, right? And here's how we do it. And this is like kind of a fundamental, like, philosophical principle, even though it's super simple, that we will kind of hammer on, which is, if I even said that name by default is a empty string, my red squiggly went away. I could even say that title by default is an empty string, that level is by default zero, and that isOnline by default is false. And I can save that file. And you'll notice, not only did all my red squigglies go away, despite strict mode being turned on, that this is still valid, at least JSX, right? You know, if one turned these HTML looking tags back into their, like, representation, this would be valid JavaScript that we could even paste into the browser, like, console and see. Like, we can't because it's JSX, but, like, TypeScript's not the culprit there. JSX is. And so what you can see is that if we have given TypeScript any way to even allude to the hint of what this might be, it then does the rest. So if, like, we feel like our TypeScript in our current app is really noisy and all those things, and it feels like a chore, right, there is a path towards, and this will be a thing that we'll see and build on top of, you know, with hooks and with reducers and with API calls, so on and so forth, to kind of try to keep this alive as much as possible. Will we have to write TypeScript at some point? Of course we will. But the goal is, again, to kind of mostly get all the benefits whilst also keeping it out of the way. Like, again, where trying to use something like TypeScript or whatever might start to feel cumbersome, I would then challenge you to be like, okay, is there a simpler way to do that? And that's why we're in this course together, is to figure out the simpler ways to do it. What if, instead of for this button that I'm not really using just yet, or for the form, what if instead of trying to, let's say that it is, like, if you're building a design system, you might have a button. Like, arguably, that is, like, the canonical component in a design system. It's probably the first one you make is button. But you might also have a form. So if we look at button, we go to HTML button attributes, you can see that it's got all the attributes of an HTML element, all the aria tags, all the tab index, so on and so forth. And it also has all of these button-like things. That's that one that we were joking about earlier. It's got the do not use or you will be fired experimental form actions. We don't have to re-implement all these things ourselves. So if one was building a design system with React and TypeScript, the meme where it's like the brain gets bigger and then it's galaxy brain, like, the first panel on that is, I'm gonna put an on click on my button handler. And then I'm gonna put a aria role on there. I'm gonna put every prop one by one on a component. And that's where you're like, I hate TypeScript, I'm not doing this anymore. And either you have an incomplete button element, or you give up, or whatever. And I want to show you that actually, in the same way we actually saw before, that you can have, like, all of these types are just types that we can use, we can actually say that this button element that we're going to work on in a second is not only our special props from our design system, but also it should also take all the props that a button takes. That way you're not implementing them one by one and hoping that you have it exactly right, so on and so forth. We can say that our counter form props is actually gonna take just like, sure, maybe it takes like one or two extra things, like what variant or what size or what layout you want for that are unique to your design system or your components. Because again, maybe you're not working on a design system, but you probably have some components in your code base. And probably some of them just wrap various HTML elements, and you want them to be able to also, because this is like counterform wraps a form, right? And we had on submit, but forms can do a lot of things. If I wanted to have all of the attributes of a form plus anything else special that we care about, I need a way to do that. And luckily, there is a very easy way to do that. So let's do it. And this is, we're going to kind of call this, it's tricky what the actual name is. We're going to call it mirroring HTML props, right? Or HTML attributes, right? So that we can have our components that become like a superset of all the things in a given HTML element. So we can do that. I'm going to do it to the form, and then I'll have you do it to the button. If we remember all the way back in our brain cells earlier, we had that props with children. Do you remember that one? That was to say like, hey, this takes some props and also we'll correctly prop children to be optionally react.react node. Turns out React has a bunch of other utility types that make stuff easy for us, and we'll also learn later how to make our own when React doesn't, but let's start with one that is incredibly useful if you, again, are building components that should wrap HTML elements and you don't want to necessarily like have to add support for every single data attribute you might want. You want to be like, be like an HTML button with a few extra things that I care about. It's a very, very, very common pattern, and where I see both previous younger versions of myself, my teammates, and stuff along those lines make some interesting choices. So I will do it to this form and you will do it to the button, which is, again, we just basically tried to re-implement one tiny little slice of an HTML form component. What we can do is you've got component props and you've got component props with and without ref. I usually tend to prefer without the ref because you can use like a forward ref higher order component and use imperative handler and all bunch of other stuff that is nice for design systems if you're using a ref. And if you're not using a ref, then there's another compelling case in why component props without ref is in there. But like, use that one, or I don't know, use the other one if you really care. I like this one. Where component props without ref, and we can see that it's angry at me because it does take some type of generic, which is an argument for a type, and that should extend React element type. You're like, what is that? I don't know, right? And so we do the braces. If we start with a string, we can basically say, component props without ref will basically say, take all of the attributes from a form. Get me all of them as props. And so now if you look, onSubmit is not a red squiggly line of sadness, right? OnSubmit is exactly what we typed it earlier. With that, this can be kind of our basic action, and that's fine. This is now a string that doesn't really get us a lot of like wonderfulness, but it's better than what we had before. Where this becomes super interesting is when we kind of like take objects that are very similar in their shape and use them in a union. And that's what we'll mean by discriminated union, right? And so if we said something like, I'll use an interface here because I think it's easier. Interface increment action. And you can do it with a type just as easily. Extends action. But the type is going to be increment. And you can do that for the rest of them too. I regret turning off Copilot because like getting that to automatically do that for me right now would have been great. Decrement action.
And we can say type is decrement. And I'm gonna make one more actually. I'm gonna make one called set count action, which is gonna take the type, and that is gonna be set count. And we're gonna say that the payload, I could make it an object like that. I'm just gonna say it can be a number right now because I'm very lazy. Right, so we have effectively, what you angry about? Interface, yeah, if you start talking and stop typing, things don't work. Cool. And so we have these, where discriminated union comes in is we do this now. We'll say, type counteraction, which is either a increment action or a decrement action or a set count action, right? What is happening behind the scenes is it now knows that type can only be one of these three things. So if we look, we say, oh, like I actually set it in the function though. Just typing in here doesn't do anything for me. We'll say it's now a counteraction. And you'll see a few things. One, reset, update draft count, and update count from draft are no longer valid action types, right? Because action type can be one of three things, increment, decrement, or set count, right? So these are no longer valid in this case. So that's cool. So let's get rid of those. And we'll say if action.type equals, equals, equals. Two things to notice here. One, again, no copilot on, no Claude code, no cursor, nothing, right? Mostly so I can make points like this. It knows that it should be set count. And you're like, why just set count? If I was to move the same line up here, it could be any of the three. If I were to move it down here, it can only be two of them, right? And if we read the code, the logic makes sense, which is we said, if it's increment, do something and return, which means by the time the TypeScript has gotten here, we know it can no longer be increment, right? And so we know it could either be decrement or set count. And then finally, when we're down here, we know that it can only be set count because we've returned if it was increment, we've returned if it was decrement. TypeScript is like whittling down the options as we go along. And so we do set type, or action type is set count. It knows that. And we can come up with whatever the new logic is. And we'll say new count equals, equals, equals. Or no, that's not how that works. Just because I typed equals, equals that many times doesn't mean that's true anymore. Is equal to action.payload. And the other interesting that we'll notice is that it knows that action.payload is a number because it knows that it is this last one and the payload of that one is a number. If I did like a console log action.payload here, it's unknown, right? And the reason for that is because the default action that we're extending from says the payload is unknown. So we don't know what it is, but we said, if it is a set count action with the type set count, then the payload is definitely a number.